he's already jumped in on an AP Chem class and started teaching, so I can already recognize his passion for science. We have some more time for later on with the science classes in the A period. So his background in science is obviously a big part of who he is. But real quickly, he also is a professor of geology at Harvard University. He has got his BS in geology at Yale University, and his PhD from UC Berkeley. And he's also on the council for science and technology for President Obama. So he's got quite a few hats, and I'm excited to have lunch also with Dr. Schneider and to hear him speak later and take questions. So without any further ado, oh, also on the sheet, even though he's a Harvard guy, he's a Yankee fan. How about that?
All right, I guess we're going to get started. Can everyone hear me? Is this working all right? You want to do a sound check?
No, I think we're good. It's a little strange to have the audience here, but we'll
have to have you back in a little more than a year when that field behind us has an auditorium in it, and it's going to be right. Brandon Benjamin Hall.
I just apologize to the people over here. I'm slanted this way, so if I forget to look back over here, I'll keep trying to check in with you guys, especially the eighth graders over here.
So my name is Dirk Ziff. I'm the parent of William, the eighth grader who's over there, who's embarrassed that I just mentioned his name, and Tatiana, the sixth grade. And I've been honored to help out with the Leadership Speaker Series program, and have been looking forward to this day for a while. And I've known Dr. Schreck for a number of years, primarily because he was a high school buddy of my brother at Fieldston School in New York City. To international prominence as an expert in climate science and the implications of it. And I'm very honored that you're here, Dan. It's great to be with you always. And what we're going to do is a format that we've experimented with in the past, just a preview for those who haven't been here for one of these. This is something that Professor Schreck wanted to do as well. Instead of him standing at a podium and going through a presentation that he's done before, we're going to have a little conversation. He has some idea what I might ask, but I might surprise him as well. And after maybe 20 minutes or so, we'll start looking around and encouraging you all to participate. And I'm told that Ethan and Courtney are going to be looking especially for eighth graders who want to ask questions. So we'll just try to incorporate your questions, and I think we're going until 11:50. And so why don't we just get started? I want to start by, this is a room full of people who are trying to imagine their own futures. When you were in high school, did you know that this is what you were going to dedicate your life to?
Absolutely not. And I actually still don't know what I'm going to devote my life to. I like to think there's still enough of my life in front of me that there might be a few other opportunities. How it happens, I knew in high school that I liked science. Your brother and I were physics together and math together. We were both good science students. And so I knew I always liked science. In college, well, let's put it this way. If you had asked me in high school would I become a professor of geology, I would have laughed in your face. In my high school, geology was what you took if you didn't take biology, if you didn't like science, you took earth science. And so I knew nothing about earth science. And I was a New York City kid, so I didn't know anything about geology. For me, mountains in Maine that were 900 feet tall were mountains. I'd never seen mountains before. And so geology was this abstract concept that was a million miles away from my consciousness. In college, it turns out I thought I wanted to be a physicist. I took physics. And I discovered something that maybe some of you will discover someday, which is that the thing that you're really passionate about, you just aren't very good at. I took my freshman year in college, I took a really hard physics course, and I worked so hard, I did the best I could, and I just wasn't very good. It turned out I was actually plenty good, it's just that there were some kids who were much better. That happens sometimes. And I didn't want to leave science, I always loved science. And so I sort of came to earth science through the back door. A professor of mine said, why don't you go take a course in geophysics and geochemistry? Try it. And I did it, and I loved it.
And when did that turn
it really happened much later, first in graduate school, where what I studied in graduate school was the chemical processes that give rise to our ability to reconstruct climate in the past. And I'm talking about a long time ago, 100 years ago. And so what I was studying is how do you do that? How do you actually measure the temperature of the ocean 100 years ago to get it back? And
how do you know you got it right?
That's the challenge. That's really where I went. And then, really, when I started teaching, I first taught at Princeton for a few years. Frankly, it's hard not to study anything related to climate change in Earth history and not be interested in how it relates to what we're seeing in the world today.
So, when did you realize that what you were interested in was also a potentially critically important global phenomenon with political, economic, social implications on a vast scale?
I think I gradually became aware of that in graduate school. But it's really been over the last 20 years or so of teaching that I've come to just appreciate the scale of the problem, deepen my own understanding of economics and politics, and really realized how big the problem is. That's what makes this problem so interesting, is that it's actually
interesting and vexing. Well, let's turn to the science. I know people are interested in the science and why it's so compelling for people like you, and also would like to talk about why it's something that other people are skeptical of, and how you feel about that, and what you would say to somebody disagrees with the science that you're doing. But let's start with, your opinion on a scale of 1 to 10, how compelling as a scientist, just clinically looking at evidence, how compelling is the evidence that not only is the climate changing, but that human activity is contributing to that process?
It's a 10. It's as much as anything we understand about science. It's really the evidence that humans have a role in changing the climate is absolutely certain. The question is how much future change will occur. That's where there's a lot of uncertainty.
Can you take us through, because there may be some people in the room who aren't sure they believe that. Can you take us through a few pieces of evidence that you consider particularly difficult to disagree with?
Yeah, a picture is worth a thousand words, so I have very few pictures for people. Can you just turn on these slides? Just a few pictures so people understand what I'm talking about. This first picture is just what's called the helium curve. It's the record of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. So again, this is just a direct measurement of carbon dioxide rising in the atmosphere. The idea that carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas, again, it's not a theory, it's something that's been around for, we've known that for more than 100 years. In fact, we measure carbon dioxide by measuring the absorption of infrared radiation, which is heat. And so,
is it worth pausing for a second to make sure everyone's clear about what a greenhouse gas means, besides the fact that it makes things warmer?
Yeah, absolutely. It works like a greenhouse where essentially, so the way the Earth's temperature is regulated is that we get solar energy from the sun, and it's mostly in the visible ultraviolet light. So sunlight comes in, mostly in the visible. Some of it's reflected back to space by clouds, by ice on the surface, but some of it is absorbed by the surface of the Earth. And when the Earth absorbs that sunlight, it heats up. And we all know this. We go out in the sun, we get warmer. We can feel our skin warming up. It turns out that there's an invisible sort of light that we then emit back to space. All objects that are hot emit that. It's infrared radiation that goes back out to space. And on balance, the amount of incoming is very close to the same as what goes back out.
And that's the equilibrium.
And that's this equilibrium. Now, if we didn't have an atmosphere, the Earth would be about 15 degrees below 0 Celsius average. The whole Earth would be frozen if we didn't have an atmosphere.
It's so the atmosphere is itself a greenhouse.
The greenhouse atmosphere, which is CO2, water vapor and CO2 are the two most important greenhouse gases. If we didn't have that atmosphere, the Earth would be frozen. It's the greenhouse gases in the atmosphere that actually keep the Earth habitable, that actually keep the Earth's temperature what it is, keeps the ocean liquid. So that's really not a debate. The question then is, as we change carbon dioxide levels, which is one of the main greenhouse gases, how is it going to warm the climate? It's going to warm it, the question is how much. And this just shows, sorry, go back, I left the clicker, but if you can just advance. So this just shows the rise of carbon dioxide, and we know this is due to burning fossil fuels. So human role in this is it's just absolutely certain. We can measure the isotopes of carbon and show that actually it comes from burning of fossil fuel. It's very clear, and it starts basically creating the industrial revolution, and we know that that's when CO2 begins. If we take a longer view, I view this curve as a geologist. Go to the next slide, please. So this is now the same graph. This is carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, but it's now over a much longer time scale. It's a measurement in parts per million, and it's over the last 650,000 years. And the way this is measured is we actually drill ice cores in Antarctica and measure air bubbles and measure how much carbon dioxide is in those air bubbles. So we can reconstruct the carbon dioxide levels in the past.
And you know when those air bubbles were formed, by how deep in the ice they are.
Exactly. And we can reproduce it in multiple cores. So this is very, very, we have a high confidence in this. And you can see there's been a lot of fluctuations over the last 600,000 years. Carbon dioxide ranged from about a low of 180 parts per million to a high of about, well, got to be almost 300 parts per million. Okay? And just to put it in perspective, 20,000 years ago, the last time this carbon dioxide was 180 parts per million, that was the last glacial maximum, the last ice age. So sea level was about 400 feet below Earth because there was so much ice on land. The ice didn't come to Florida, it came from New York City. Okay, there was a huge, this was a different world.
20,000 years ago.
20,000 years ago.
Which sounds like a long time, but really
geologically, it's ticked a lot. That's right. So, and you can see that rise. Now, this is all about rate. You can see that looks like a pretty fast change coming out of the last glacial maximum. That rise in carbon dioxide from 180 parts per million to 280 parts per million, that took 10,000 years. So it seems fast, but it was slow relative to different time scales. Now, here's what the Industrial Revolution did. Can you put the next slide, please? So that yellow line on the right, that's where we are in 2014. We're very close to 400 parts per million. Okay, and that happened mostly in the last 100 years.
So is it fair to say, based on this, that what we're experiencing now is an unfortunate combination of the natural cycle coinciding with the Industrial Revolution, that the carbon dioxide was on the rise, and then we contributed to it, and that's why we're so high?
Unfortunately not, because in fact, carbon dioxide since the last 7,000 or 8,000 years was actually stable. So it actually was pretty stable for the last 7,000 or 8,000 years, and then started going up. And in the next 50 years or so, to the next slide, you can see, we're going to be off the graph here. That's going to be about 500 parts per million. And we'll be there by mid-century, guaranteed. So think of this as an experiment we're doing with Europe. We're doing an experiment that hasn't been done for millions of years. And nobody knows exactly what's going to happen. But frankly, we know enough about the basic physics of carbon dioxide that we expect more to happen. Now, why am I so certain that what we're seeing today really is due to this carbon dioxide rise? There's lots of reasons. More than I could possibly talk about in an hour here. But let me just give you one anecdote. There's a friend of mine named Lonnie Thompson. Lonnie's at Ohio State University. He's a superhero. He is a glaciologist who studies high altitude glaciers. He doesn't go to Antarctica or Greenland. He goes to Peru. He goes to New Guinea. He goes to Kilimanjaro. And he climbs up 22, 23, 24,000 feet. And then stays there for months at a time. Solar-powered drilling equipment, drilling ice cores, and bringing that down. He has spent 4 years of his life above 20,000 feet.
Why does he do it there as opposed to?
He has to go up because on the equator, the ice is only there at very high altitude where it gets very cold, and the equator is a very special part of the Earth system. So one thing about the equator, especially when you're away from the surface, is it doesn't have any seasonality, and the temperature is amazing. So what he's noticed is the temperature in the equator has been rising. He proved this from his ice core. So just here's one example. Go to the next slide, please. One more, please. So this is a picture we took in the 70s of a ice cap in Peru called the Kaya Ishii, the Coricales Glacier. And in 2002, take the next one, please. That's what that same site looked like. And if you went back today, you wouldn't see ice at all. It would be all receded even further back. This has happened not just in Peru, Guinea, Kilimanjaro, all over the world. Melania has documented with its ice cores that the equator is warming. It's kind of like the canary in the coal mine. It's warming, and it's happening all over the equator. And it hasn't happened for thousands, sometimes tens of thousands of years. That tells you this isn't part of some natural cycle. This is really extraordinary, and it's coincident with this velocity.
Let's talk about sort of what has actually happened in the world that we can observe besides the pictures of glaciers. Because I'm curious how much of this is sort of just anecdotal, theoretical, pop science, and how much of it is real. You hear a lot about extreme weather. And my own impression is that whenever there's a flood in Europe or a hurricane in New York City or anything that gets a lot of attention, people associated with climate change. Is that fair, or is that being overdone?
The answer is yes and no. In general, so we've had extreme weather events in the past, we'll have them in the future. Weather and climate are connected, but they're not the same thing. I think the best way to explain it is sort of changing the, it's like changing the dice. Or maybe think of a roulette wheel, where you're spinning a wheel looking for a particular number to come up. And by increasing the area on the wheel of that particular number, you're changing the odds of the game. And that's the way you can think about it. What's happening as the Earth warms is certain types of weather phenomena shift or become more extreme floods, for example. There's a good theoretical reason for thinking that as the moisture, as the air warms, the air holds more water in it. That's just a basic physical process. And it turns out that therefore rain events become more intense. So there's a prediction that we should expect to see more intense rainfall events. Now, does that mean when there's an intense rainfall event here in Florida, it's due to global warming? Well, it might have been happened anyway, but the probability that it's going to happen becomes more likely as the warming happens. So it's always, it's a very difficult question. You can never attribute a particular storm or a particular weather event to climate change. But you can say climate change is affecting all weather. It's changing the odds, changing the statistics of the patterns. About 10 years ago, there was a nighttime tornado in Miami. Remember that? Terrifying. And tornado at nighttime is particularly scary. It's too unusual. Miami doesn't change. People were saying, oh, it's global warming. Well, maybe, but it hasn't happened again. It was a very unusual weather pattern. But figuring out whether it was actually connected to the overall warming of the planet, very difficult.
Let's talk about climate scales. You called it a 10 on a scale of 1 to 10 in terms of the quality of the scientific evidence. When we spoke earlier, I asked you, is there any serious debate within the scientific community that you're aware of about this? Told me you didn't think there was any. And yet, there's a significant percentage of the population that wonders if this is really true or if it's being overstated. Why do you think that is?
Well, I guess I'm sort of used to it being so politicized. I've gotten a little bit numb to its effects. I think there's a couple of things. First of all, don't confuse the certainty that it's happening with the fact that everything, that we're certain about everything that's going to happen. Again, this is an experiment we're doing with the planet that hasn't been done for millions of years. No scientist is smart enough to make a perfect prediction with as complicated a system as the Earth. So the answer is, there's all sorts of things we don't understand. This is a really difficult problem. And I promise you, if I came back here 2 years from now, there would be surprises and things that we've learned in the next 2 years, and everything. I have something new to tell you that I didn't know right now. That's what makes this feel so exciting, is it's constantly changing, it's complicated. So don't confuse the high confidence that this is actually happening to, oh, I know everything about it. You don't have to be humble in that respect. This is a complex system, and there will be surprises.
Have you had a conversation with a climate skeptic that made you pause and search and go, that's a good point?
You know, not with science. But, and by the way, I don't like to call them climate skeptics, because the reason is skeptics are, I don't think I'm a climate skeptic. I'm a scientist, and therefore I'm always skeptical. I want to see the evidence.
Right.
It's not based on belief, it's based on evidence. And skeptics, we all should be skeptical. What I would call them climate deniers, because these are people who don't have open minds. They have a very firm belief that this is not happening. In general, that's my experience. They're not skeptical, they're denying the existence of this. It's about the same percentage of people in this country who deny the existence of evolution, which is also pretty broadly accepted by the scientific community. And I think it's actually an interesting, similar phenomenon. You know, in the case of evolution, it's very much along religious lines. And in climate change, it's much more along climate issue has been associated with a set of political beliefs, passion for environmentalism, certain government policies like carbon taxes, regulation, that are really hostile to some people's ideology. And so I've actually talked to people, you know, oil executives in Texas who say, well, I believe in climate change, but I don't believe in climate change. It sounds silly, but what they're really saying is, you know, I believe in the science of climate change. I accept, as a smart technical person, I accept the evidence of what's happening. And yet, I don't buy into carbon taxes, regulation, all the things. And in some ways, that's the problem in this country that we haven't had. We've been so worried about fighting about the science that we haven't actually had the important discussion about, okay, what do you do about it? And there are different philosophies about how do you approach these sorts of grand problems.
So let's talk about implications. This clearly, as you say, is an experiment. By the way, I want to circle back. You said it hasn't happened for millions of years, twice. What happened millions of years ago that was like this?
I mean, you know something about this, Dirk, I know. Dirk is pretending to be naive, but he actually has read quite a bit about this. So there are a number of examples. Probably the last time there were about 500 parts per time period called the Eocene. Eocene was a very warm climate. There was no ice anywhere on Antarctica or Greenland. There were crocodiles or relatives to modern crocodiles living up near the Arctic Circle. There were palm trees in Wyoming. Very different climate. Very warm. Sea level was about 100 meters higher than today. So this is a very different world.
So no Florida at all.
No Florida at all. It's not going to happen in the next 100 years. It may happen eventually, but it's not going to happen in the next 100 years. Florida will still exist in some capacity. In general, I think this is going to be... So a particular event I like to think about happened about 55 million years ago. It was, I think, the best natural analog to what we're seeing today. We still argue about exactly why this happened, but the evidence is very clear that over a period of a few thousand years, and this is longer than what we're doing it in a few hundred years, but over 2,000 to maybe 10,000 years, a large amount of carbon dioxide was released to the atmosphere, so the concentration in the atmosphere roughly tripled. Now, to put that in perspective, that's roughly what we're going to do over the next 100 years. Okay? We're likely to triple the atmospheric concentration of carbon dioxide. We think this happened 55 million years ago, and we know that the Earth warmed by about 6 degrees Celsius, which is about 10 degrees Fahrenheit. That's a lot. That's a big deal. Now, this was a very different planet then. The Earth was already quite warm, so there was no ice to melt. So sea level didn't change that much because changed a little bit, it changed a few meters because of the warming of the oceans, but it didn't change by tens of meters because there was no ice to melt.
Sorry, about as high as it was going to get.
I told you that Florida's going to go underwater over the next 1,000 years, you probably wouldn't care so much. Whereas if I tell you that it's going to go over the next 50 years, you care a lot.
How much do you care?
Well, the answer is, this is one of the things we really don't know. I think somewhere here I had a slide showing sea level rise. Can you go through the next couple slides? Okay, here's mine. So this is the observations of sea level, global sea level rise. It used to be that it came from tide gauges all over the world, and it's complicated because some parts of the world are sinking and some parts of the world are rising up. So it's figuring out what the global average is really tricky. You can see there's a lot of uncertainty earlier in the record around 1880 and 1900. But then you can see the sea level rise, it was rising about 0.9 millimeters per year, and then 2 millimeters per year, a little bit faster. And then the red is the satellite measurements. In the last 20 years or so, we've had a satellite called TOPEX, which measures the height of the sea surface very, very precisely. And so we now have really good measurements of sea level. And it's been rising a little bit faster. Now it's currently rising close to 3.5 millimeters a year. That's not that much. I mean, you know, 3.5 millimeters a year. So, you know, so that's in 10 years, that's, you know, 35 millimeters. You know, you can think of that as 3.5 centimeters, that's like 1.5 inches. Right? That's not so much every decade. The problem is this trend towards acceleration. It's accelerating. And that's what we worry about, the ice sheets. But it's very uncertain. We know that Greenland is melting today. We know that Antarctica is melting as well, although it's so big that it's melting very slowly. But the question is, how much will it accelerate? And the range of estimates of what sea level rise is going to be by the end of the century is huge. You know, some people think it will be 20 or 30 centimeters, which is like this much. Right now, will that affect Florida? Absolutely. This much sea level rise will definitely affect Florida. Places like the Everglades, profoundly affected. But that's a lot less than if it were a meter, right? And then suddenly, vast parts of Florida begin to suffer much more. If you go forward another 100 years, now things become more uncertain, but the numbers get bigger. So now you're talking about 2 or 3 meters. And now we're saying, you know, 2 or 3 meters, places like Palm Beach become difficult to live, certainly in different places. And so I don't know whether it's going to be 200 years or 500 years, but certainly on that time scale, Florida eventually will become uncountable.
Let me ask one question about where we go as a global society from here, what you think is realistic, big picture, and I want to open up the question for the students. You're describing this as a process that happens too slowly to actually see with your own eyes, fast enough to be terrifying to a scientist, but slow enough so that it's not hugely compelling to the politicians of today to deal with, because the problems are not going to show up in 2 or 3 years while they're still in office. So given that this is a global political problem as well as an environmental problem, how can we deal with the fact that the time frame is outside of the personal interest of the people in power?
So, Dirk, this is exactly to me what makes the problem so more interesting than all climate science is where the climate science collides with energy technology and the politics and economics of all of this. One thing I want to just say, go back a slide. Here's a picture of the Arctic sea ice from 2012. The idea that we can't see this happening, I would just bicker a little bit of that, because if you look at the Arctic, you know, the sea ice is almost gone most of the time. It's extraordinary. If you know anything about the history of the Arctic, of Amundsen's explorations 100 years ago, trying to get through the Northwest Passage, we could go on a 20-foot motorboat cruising through the Northwest Passage any time this summer, in August. That's extraordinary. It took Amundsen 3 years to get through.
Let's do it.
And we should do that at some point. And by the way, there will be tour boats going through there at some point. You know, not only was the Northwest Passage open, the Northeast Passage over Russia was wide open. First time this ever happened, 2010. Never in the history of humanity. We know about a time when you could go from the Atlantic to the Pacific over Russia without being impeded by ice. It's sort of extraordinary. So these are changes that we're actually seeing. But in terms of solutions, you know, the nature of this problem is that if we're using fossil fuel, we're taking solar energy that was made into plant material hundreds of millions of years ago and buried underground. We're using that energy now over a period of 100 years or a few hundred years.
You're talking about oil.
Oil, coal, and gas.
Fossil fuels.
That's right. And so what we're doing is we're perturbing the Earth's carbon cycle by using all this organic carbon and burning it and turning it into carbon dioxide very quickly. So the atmosphere, on a time scale of tens of thousands of years, the Earth will handle it. The Earth will recover. The problem is we have to live through the next few thousand years until we've gotten the consequences. And so we're overwhelming the system. The problem is that fossil fuels are so cheap and so cheap. It's amazing how inexpensive fossil fuels are compared to most of the alternatives. Now, there's some places that have hydroelectric power that's very economical. And there's some places that believe that nuclear energy will someday be extremely economical. In some places, it has been in the past. But in general, fossil fuels are economical, and they're tough to beat. The other thing is the time scale of building out the infrastructure. The thing about energy that's different than things like information technology or biotechnology is the infrastructure. So it requires trillions of dollars of infrastructure, of transmission lines, power plants, and stuff in your homes. So replacing all that over a decade or two is just not possible. This is going to be a long time scale. So not only is it a long time scale over which this is occurring, which is way longer than the political cycle of 2 or 4 years, longer than the corporate time scale of quarterly reports, but in addition, you know, it's a global problem. What the climate system cares about is cumulative use of fossil fuels by the whole world. The U.S. is no longer even a big emitter. China's, the last 5 years, China went from being roughly tied with the U.S. They now have roughly 60% more emissions than the U.S. in 5 years.
But 4 times the number of people.
It's true that they still have 4 times the number of people, although it turns out that that's often a little bit of it's a strange concept because there's really 2 Chinas, right? If you go to Shanghai, there are people as wealthy as any of us living in Shanghai, very fancy houses using lots and lots of fossil fuel. And then there's rural poor in China that are as poor as anybody in the world. And that dichotomy is very interesting. Stunning.
I'd like to get the students involved. Do you want to?
Yeah, I actually think we should start with the